make my own way. Occupation. Housewife. I don't think so. I swore I would never be a housewife. I would never do the drudgery demanded of women. You see, I wanted to make the decisions, the important decisions. I wanted women to share in the power. I spent my life looking for my role, the role of women, a role apart from marriage and family. So long as women are content to tend the home fires, then all is well. But if we dare to meddle in politics, if we dare to clean up the road, then we are insulted at home, in the newspapers, and at political rallies. To deny women the right of lawmaking is to deny the very principle of democracy. The woman's point of view has been ignored in the making of our laws. Let's look at the facts. In criminal law, the abduction of a young girl into white slavery merits a sentence of 5 years imprisonment, while the theft of a cow is punishable by 14. Under the Homestead Act, only men are entitled to free land. In family law, a father is given sole guardianship of the children. A father may put his children up for adoption, and the mother has no legal right to stop him. In property law, a man may sell all the property to which he holds title, put his wife and children out on the street, and move on to greener pastures. And what does the Attorney General of Manitoba have to say about this gross injustice? A husband is never far wrong, and is better capable than anyone else of judging what he should leave to his wife. When he leaves her penniless, there is good reason. The time, January 1914. The place, the Walker Theater in downtown Winnipeg. Our plan, a mock parliament, a satire of Premier Roblin's performance the day before in the legislature, a performance in which he dared to deny us the vote. Our members of parliament, of course, were women. I took on the role of Premier Roblin. I was to receive a delegation of men from the province of Manitoba asking for the vote. I practiced.
Oh, did I practice until I had the voice and the mannerisms of the great man down pat. I strode up to the podium, took out my notes, and began. Thank you, gentlemen. On behalf of all the members of this assembly, I thank you and applaud the hard work that has gone into your petition. Now, I must say that seldom has this legislature been witness to such a fine-looking delegation of gentlemen. Such handsome fellows you are in your top hats and waistcoats. You must be a credit to your wives and families. But having said that, I must tell you that I cannot do what your petition asks me to do. Please, let me continue. Now, I cannot assume that all gentlemen are as intelligent as you appear to be. Most criminals, you know, are men. Are not men the drinkers? Now, I am sure that no one here tonight is of this sort. However, by enfranchising all men, you enfranchise these low-life creatures as well. Please, let me finish. Now, we know that men are made for higher and better things than voting. Men are made to support families. The man who pays the grocer rules the world.
What is a home, after all, without a bank account?
A man's place is on the farm, behind the plow. But more than this, we know that men are too sensitive for the rough and tumble world of politics. Politics unsettles men. And unsettled men mean unsettled bills, broken homes, broken furniture, divorce. And you're asking for the vote. You are asking me to break up peaceful, happy homes. In Brandon, I was burned in effigy. One little political cartoon had me as Calamity Nell, brandishing an axe. And so was born my personal motto. Never retract, never explain, never apologize. Just get the job done and let them howl. On October 18th, 1929, newspaper headlines across the British Empire read, "Privy Council declares that women are persons." We one. Victory was sweet. The exclusion of women from public office is a relic of times more barbarous than ours, the Privy Council said. Women have the right to participate fully in the public life of the nation. They have the right to equality. So my occupation, this question on the census form, one line to describe her life. Indeed, who am I? Nellie McClung. I've been a teacher, a wife, a mother, a suffragist, a temperance worker, a politician, speaker, writer. And who am I? One thing is for sure. I am not the property of a husband or father. I have an identity independent of any other human being. I'm a person. Thanks to the work that Week 5 initiated, I am a person. That's my contribution. That's how I made a difference. And so for all people and all time, for men and women, I am a person. That's what I write on the census form. That is who I am.